Stella by
Stella by Starlight.
Favorite song.
Beautiful song. Ladies and gentlemen, my special guest today is Mike Greensill. Yay.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. So honored to have you on and to be able to speak with you, and your notoriety and respect in the field is so great.
That's good to know. One doesn't think of that yourself, you know. I wonder how my notoriety is this morning. Yes.
That was a very good response. Somehow I knew I could depend on you for a response like that. it's just so beautiful to hear a piano player such as yourself, and the bass player too. Who is the bass player on that?
John Whitala.
Beautiful. Yeah. And I must say that video he sounds really good on that video. It's yeah. very present, the bass. Yeah. It's just so wonderful to hear a piano player such as yourself to play. It's a more than an intellectual experience. It's a real sensuous experience because of your feel and the space around what you play and your touch on the piano. So, it can't really get better than that.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
You're welcome.
I was thinking about that approach the other day because I think I talked about it on my Facebook Live show, and it's to do with that I'm really an imposter. I'm not really a piano player because I never practiced scales and arpeggios because all I wanted to do was play tunes. So I learned to play the piano by playing hundreds of tunes, and then finding different ways about them. And then you get with a singer and you find you have to play them in any key possible. So I actually think that I don't recommend it for everyone, but I think it's held me in good stead that I don't have that sort of technique of playing fast scales or anything like that. So I'm not tempted to use them to make the music. Which is why I always think of myself as a jazz musician who happens to have chosen the piano, not a pianist,
That's very interesting, yeah. I mean, being a singer, I can kind of relate to that because, especially nowadays, all singers are learning scales, right. And you can see it, in their performances, they're very accomplished in that way. I learned scales on the way up, but it wasn't a real applied way of learning,
No.
So if I scat, it's not about the scalar approach. No. I remember at times, musicians would tell me I was singing the wrong note, which always killed me. It was like, what do you mean I'm singing the wrong note? It's what you do with the note. It's not, you're singing this tension note against a chord. Yeah. And then there were those piano players who would play the right note for me. Oh man, that would really piss me off. when you solo, the experience for you is just a musical response, right? Of what you know the song to be, the chords to be. I'm sure you read music, right?
Yeah, not great. One of my regrets, I wish I was a better reader. I'd had a slightly different career, maybe. I don't know whether a more satisfying one, but I certainly would have gotten a few more important gigs if I had been a really good reader. I mean, I'm a good reader in the big band sense of the word. I'm fine with, lead charts and rhythms and all that. But if it looks like Chopin and you put it up in front of me, no, it's not going to happen. So,
yeah. Okay.
No Chopin.
Yeah, no Chopin.
I've, one of the worst gigs I did, unfortunately, because she was a friend, is a friend, Rita Moreno.
Yeah.
She liked my work with my wife, Weslia. And so she hired me for a gig. And I got there and it looked like Chopin. The church. It's a horror. So.
Yeah, that's an awkward position, isn't it?
Yeah. I remember there's a famous Jimmy Rolls story. Jimmy is just my favorite piano player and accompanist. And
he was apparently great.
He was doing some studio work and the conductor, you know, started the orchestral introduction and turned to Jimmy. And Jimmy looked at him and said, "You're not going to get this out of me today." Because it looked like Chopin.
Anyway. That's funny. And he was so great.
Oh.
He such a nice man, too. Wow.
Yeah. I only met him when I had lunch with him once in LA. So I didn't meet him.
He's one of those guys that I call the royalty of jazz, you know?
Right.
Like they have such amazing heritage and they're so gracious, you know, and warm. Mm-hmm. And his daughter was like that too.
Oh yeah,
Stacy. And she was so musical. Oh my God.
Oh yeah, lovely.
Yeah, she was amazing. I remember talking to Jimmy about that tape. Remember that tape that?
Oh,
that
with Billie Holiday. Yeah.
Where they were going through songs, and she was talking like she was. Kind of like she was loaded. And then she started singing and it was magnificent.
Oh yeah.
And he said he was so pissed off that that tape got out without, you know, just kind of floating around, you know.
Yeah, it was one of those things that, you know, a lot of us had a rough cassette of it. And then it got released as a CD, didn't it, eventually?
But he didn't get any money.
Oh,
gee. God.
Welcome to the world of jazz.
Jeez. I was just talking about, you know, the deep rabbit hole of all the different questions and non-rules that go along with, you know, recording and, you know, just, you know, should I make money from it? Should I not? Do I care? You know, I really want to put the music out for people to enjoy, you know, all that huge rabbit hole, man, that has so many different, different opinions and questions sitting around in it, you know?
Yeah, no, that's absolutely true. But along the lines of the, you know, not making any money, I wrote the music to a Jacques Pepin cooking special. and in fact, I joined ASCAP for having done that. And then it turned out that, of course, ASCAP had a special deal with PBS and they didn't have to pay royalties. So I would occasionally get a check for $1.25 from Canada. Because it was being used for, you know, pledge specials all over the country. And I thought, oh, I'm going to make some royalties on it. No.
Oh, God. Oh, my God.
So here am I starving to death, as you can tell.
I love your place. It looks really warm and inviting.
It is. Or it could be dark and doomy, which I mean.
You're in San Francisco, right?
No, I'm in Saint Helena up in Napa Valley.
Oh, okay.
About 70 miles north of the city. Moved up here about 15 years ago. So.
Oh. I'm sorry, I forget when Weslia passed.
3 years ago. Yeah.
Oh, so sorry about that. I'm sure that was hard.
It's a tough one. And sort of don't know about it until you go through it. You know.
Yeah.
So part of you is gone, you know, and you're not getting it back. So.
Yeah. I remember when I first heard her. I was quite young. You know, I mean, I was in my 20s, I think. And I remember somebody played her for me and I was so knocked over, blown over. Obviously I was listening to you too, right?
Yeah. Because
were you her only pianist?
She made one record in 79 before I met her.
Okay.
Which she didn't like. So most of it's still under our bed. boxes under the bed, you know. So, but other than that, no, I was on everything else. So.
Yeah, so I probably heard you too.
Yeah.
And yeah, her, oh, wow. She was exquisite, such quality and perspective and musicality. I mean, they're just really astounding singer.
Yeah. But my favorite story along those lines is someone I'm sure you know, Gary Foster, wonderful saxophone player in LA. He apparently was driving on the freeway and one of the radio stations in LA, I guess K-Jazz, played a Weslia record, and he was so taken with it, he pulled off the freeway and called the station and asked who it was, because they didn't back announce it. And then he found my phone number and called me to tell me how much he liked it. And of course, then we became friends, and he's on four or five of our albums, you know. So we love Gary Foster.
Oh, yeah, Gary Foster. Yeah. Another beautiful, beautiful human being and incredible
and fabulous player. Yeah.
Who else did you guys work with? Did you change?
Our very first album together, we had Al Cohn.
Cool.
Just for a Thrill. Yeah, I'll never forget that story too. Because, you know, we were being calculating. There are no cabaret radio stations. So we figured the only way you're going to sell some records is to get airplay. So, and the only stations are going to be jazz stations. So we better get a jazz star on here. So I just called up Al. I didn't know him. It was a cold call. And he said, yeah, fine. I'm in LA. I'll come up for the day, you know. And and I picked him up at the airport. It was a one-day session. And I picked him up at the airport. And he was obviously dreadfully hungover. I mean, he was just in a state. And I remember on the drive to the studio, he said, don't worry, Mike, music always makes me feel better. And he did play great. And it turned out later, my good friend Pinky Winters, who you know, Sweetie of Lou Levy. It turns out Al had been at Lou Levy's place the night before, and Lou had kept him up till 4 a.m. drinking. He had like an hour's sleep and got a plane up to us. So it was nice to meet Lou later on, you know. Another fabulous accompanist, Lou Levy. Yeah.
Yeah, he sure was. Woo. Yeah. He was great. Yeah, I hope Pinky is going to come on there.
Yeah, where are you, Pinky?
I sent her a message, but I don't know. Let's see. Yeah, I sent her a message, but you never know. Lou Levy was really, really wonderful. Those guys, a lot of those guys from that period, like I actually recorded with Ross Tompkins.
Oh, yeah?
In a duo. And I mean, he was another amazing accompanist. The other guy, did you ever know Tom Garvin?
Yeah, I knew Tom through Gary Foster. Wonderful player.
He was one of those players that you would sing with, and then something would kind of shock you, you know, how there he was, you know. Right. Lou Matthews was like that too.
Yeah, right.
Just kind of shocking, you know. It's really, really
and the
beautiful.
Thing is, those guys could read Chopin as well, so they they had good studio careers.
Ross, he was quite a character. His wife was a very dear friend of mine, and you know, they had no piano in their house.
Oh, really?
Can you believe that?
Yeah.
And he would go around from club to club, you know. You'd see him at the various clubs in LA, like, you know, sit in for a few songs and stuff. That always blew my mind. I never asked him why he didn't have a piano, but
there was a important gig in my life going to listen, and it was somewhere in the valley, I can't remember now, but there was Ross and Jack Shelton doing a duo. Mm. And it was magic, the two of them. Just
I know. Magic.
And Jack, oh.
I know, those two were amazing. I have several of their CDs. Mm-hmm. Yeah, amazing together. And Jack was such a great singer.
Oh, I remember the first song they did that day. It was the rain comes a pitter patter, and I'd like to be safe in bed. It's a Jerome Kern tune.
Oh, what's the name of it?
Till the clouds roll by.
Oh, okay. Till the clouds roll by.
And of course, Jack, it's got an enormous range. And of course, Jack sang it fearlessly. No. Yeah, look that one up. Till the clouds roll by.
Yeah. Yeah. I know. Jack, he was a really interesting guy. He was, you know, he was kind of intimidating, but he was very nice. He was really warm and welcoming. But because of his stature, I guess, you know, just... Everything from how he carried himself to how accomplished he was a little intimidating, you know. But he was nice. He was really nice. I remember I auditioned for a show that he was, I think he had referred me actually to audition. It was it was a jazz show. The Bergmans were part of it.
Oh yeah.
And I forget who the main writer was, somebody, you know, very famous from the older days. And it was one of those auditions. They wanted to hear something that really moved you, you know? And of course, in my book, what songs moved me more than the Bergman lyrics, you know?
Right, yeah.
So I did one of those, you know, where do you start or something like that. And of course I cried in the middle, you know, cause there was this one line, you know, that was just, you know, and I was like, oh God, it's terrible when the singer cries, you know, I mean, you remember Vicky?
Can't do that. No.
Vicky Carr used to cry on every ballad she would sing, but I think she might have allowed that to happen. Weslia was she considered more of a cabaret singer?
Oh, I think so, yeah. And in fact, I mean, a couple of DJs got in trouble in the early days for playing her records because their program directors would say, that's not jazz. I remember John Rogers here, who was a great champion of ours on K-Jazz in the Bay Area, got into trouble initially for playing Weslia. So we've always had that, you know, isn't she a jazz singer? And she always used the Rosemary Clooney phrase, and Rosie would say, I'm not a jazz singer, but I hire jazz musicians.
And I think that's actually true. You know, when I grew up, one of the people I listened to a lot was Rosemary Clooney.
Yeah.
And her phrasing was jazz-like. I mean, she really wasn't a jazz singer, but her phrasing was jazz-like and just excellent phrasing. And same with Weslia.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
Weslia did develop through the years. I think when we were first together, she wasn't a real swinging singer. But that developed, and I think to do with the fact of having swinging people around her all the time, can't help but rub off on you. And because she used to sing too much. There's a wonderful essay, I can't remember whether it was in the New Yorker, by Dave Frischberg. And the title of the essay is Too Much Singing. He would get mad at singers who, through too much singing, would ignore the words. You know, too many long tones and not getting the meaning of the words across.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting essay about our style of singing, you know. And it's why Weslia left the opera. She said the opera was all about the voice, and I wanted to know about the stories of the songs. So,
yeah. I think like in my teaching, I have hosted many, many workshops with hundreds of singers.
Hang on. Decline. I thought I'd put do not disturb on, but obviously not.
I had hundreds of singers coming through and I created workshops for them over like a 20-year period. Right. And, you know, all of these teachers would always say, don't interrupt the sentence, you know.
Right.
And but then, you know, I actually got more into Carmen McRae as I grew older. And he was a singer who could interrupt any sentence and right. you were still hanging on every idea because right. her intention was so present
yeah.
that she could interrupt anywhere and it didn't matter.
Right.
So the space, of course, you know, I mean, space is, you know, God, Shirley Horn and all that stuff, you know.
Oh yeah. And Weslia would always talk about the punctuation. She'd make singers. You know, she'd say, you got to sing comma to comma and you can only emphasize one word and blah, blah, you know, in the way of getting the meaning across. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's a very interesting process.
Oh, yeah.
Singing is really so interesting. And the more present you are and the more focused on the communication of
right.
of what you're saying, it
yeah.
makes your singing, you know, it's really yeah. it's a really interesting instrument.
Which is why sometimes some of my favorite singers don't have the best voices, you know, pure voices or anything. You know,
I agree.
They communicate better. I mean,
I've
always thought that if you could take Ella's swing and intonation, Sarah's beautiful voice, and Carmen's intelligence, and put those three together, you'd have the best singer ever.
You know? You're so true. That would be like this monster singer.
Monster singer, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that's funny. I've never really thought of it that way, but that would really be amazing. I can imagine that too. Wow.
Anyway.
Yeah, there was so many good singers came out of that. I remember when I first came to LA, I was a waitress. I was 22 at Dante's.
Uh-huh.
And there was this one night that Irene Krall and Alan Broadbent played.
Oh yeah.
And it was actually she had gotten sick. So this was probably one of her last gigs, right? And the only two people in the audience were uh-huh. Sarah and Carmen. and I was their waitress.
That's a classic.
Yeah. And that was actually the first time I heard Some Other Time, which stayed with me forever yeah. after that, you know. But yeah.
Oh, that's yeah. it's so classic about our world. You know, there's these fabulous artists and only two people in the audience. I remember when we first get, this is a very West Coast centrist talk, isn't it? We haven't mentioned New York at all yet. when we first went to LA, we were at a little place called the Gardenia.
Yeah.
And we were there for 2 weekends. And we were lucky that Don Heckman from the LA Times came to review us.
Yeah.
And he loved Weslia and he said, and there were like 14 people there. And he said, if there aren't lines around the block next weekend, there's no justice. So the next weekend, there were still only 14 people there, and we knew 12 of them, you know. So the power of the press, you know.
Yeah, that's in that rabbit hole that we were talking about,
yeah,
you know.
Right.
All that stuff is like, you know, yeah, I mean, I'm actually doing a jam session again, because
yeah.
I ran a jam session for like 15 years and I afterwards I said, I'm through with jam sessions.
Right.
And here I am again, because I just don't think people, you know, enough people will come see me
yeah.
twice a month.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also I mean, during this time, I would like to give it as a gift to people yeah. who feel comfortable about coming out, you know?
Yeah.
So, but yeah. I mean, yeah, the audience thing.
That's where I feel so blessed with this Facebook Live. The one good thing to come out of the pandemic for me is discovering this method of communication.
Yeah.
So I do it 3 days a week. And at times I've had up to 2,000 listeners.
And really?
Yeah. I mean, usually it's about 200 live, and then people come afterwards and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
I think the most I've had is 2,000.
Wow.
You know, doing normal jazz club things in San Francisco or something, it might take me 10 years to get that and I have people to come. And here I have got it immediately. So
I agree. I think it's a really, I think it's great. It's a great way to reach out. Mm-hmm. And it's good for us running it, and it's good for people listening. You know, that's just so wonderful. I've been to some of your shows and it's wonderful. What time is it again? And it's Monday, Wednesday, and Friday?
Friday, 3 till 4, West Coast time, yeah. I have to say that because I have listeners in Australia who listen to me over their breakfast. So
that's nice, I like that. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, 3 to 4 Pacific time. Yes. And Mike just, he sits at the piano, he plays tunes off the top of his head, or sometimes you take...
It's well planned.
Is it?
Oh yeah, else I would panic. Yeah.
But sometimes you take requests too.
There's a lot of preparation that goes into making things look easy. Yeah, I do take requests if people, you know, people want to hear things. Absolutely.
I like stuff like. What'd you say?
I'd like to come up with a hook of something that gives me some, you know, see whose birthday it is today.
Yeah.
It's Irving Berlin's birthday today, so if I was doing one today, I'd play all Irving Berlin tunes. You know.
Happy birthday, Irving. Yeah. Well, I like stuff like what I call the hidden gems. Like I'll Be Around, you know.
Yeah. Oh,
just
yeah.
Stuff like that. It's just they're kind of not that long and they're just beautiful.
Yeah.
You know what one is really short and gorgeous? I'm sure you know it. It's by Jewel Stein. It's called Dance Only With Me.
One of my favorite tunes ever. Fabulous.
It is so short too, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's like 16 bars or something.
Right. Blossom Deary has a fabulous version of that, which is where I first heard it, is Blossom. Yeah.
It's the most beautiful little tune. Yeah. I had a fan for a while who suggested it to me. And it was just one of those songs. Again, it's just there's some kind of magic to it, you know.
And it's also astounding to me that even now I'll keep discovering new little gems. It's like you could spend a little... Wesley used to have a funny phrase about our music. She said it's what happened right after Brahms and right before Buddy Holly. repertoire. And I think you can study the popular music of 1910 to 1970, let's say 60.
Yeah,
you could spend a lifetime just studying the popular music of that time and still not know it all. which I've done, and spent a lifetime doing that.
I'm just writing down that you're on Facebook and when, you know. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I'm on this Zoom hang and it has some classical people and some jazz people, and we talk about everything. But it's really interesting to hear comments. Like there's one violinist. I take it she's young. I haven't heard her yet, but so a few of the people were saying how astounding she was. One person had seen her and was really turned off because she actually. She made a little graveyard and put Bach and Beethoven in there. and it was like, he was really turned off by that. He said, you know, you don't have to kill them off. You don't have to play them, but you don't have to kill them off either, because they existed, and you know, they existed, and they were the basis, and you know,
of all of it. Yeah, but you know that gets if we get onto jazz education, that's one thing that sort of gets my goat. If I was in charge of a 3-year course of jazz education, they wouldn't be allowed to listen to John Coltrane until the last year. They'd spend the whole first year listening to Louis Bix and Jelly Roll Morton and Early Ellington, and because no classical person would go to college and start studying Schoenberg.
That's true.
Don't do that. You
know? Yeah.
So you have to learn the history of everything so that you know where. I feel personally very lucky that what turned me on to jazz was early jazz. So when I was about 12 or 13, someone brought us a 78 to school of Louis Armstrong Hot Five, played it. I was utterly hooked. That was it. So I mean, even though that would have been, I don't know what, 1958, 59, I studied jazz up through from the very beginning. And in fact, when I first heard Charlie Parker, it took me a year to get anywhere near what he was doing. I had no idea. But I knew there was something important going on.
Yeah. So. You went to, did you go to Leeds? Is that
I went to jazz college in Leeds.
Yeah.
Which was very new then. I went in 68. They were trying to copy Berkeley, you know, and were affiliated with a classical music college, but they'd started a jazz wing. So, I had a marvelous time there. Learned a lot. Mainly I learned in the pub at lunchtime, talking to the teacher. There were a lot of times where us and the teachers never got back to the college in the afternoon.
Marvelous. See, that's definitely an expression of that part of the world, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That doesn't really happen over here.
No. Going to the pub for lunch. Okay. Good. Yeah.
I remember going to England to, I did a recording about 8 years ago there. And you know, some of those guys were really trying to not drink. They were trying, you know, you drink, and your life gets a little topsy-turvy. And I felt really bad for them because, you know, they grew up doing it, you know, and it must be really difficult, especially when you're a musician too, because it's all wrapped up. Right? It's all wrapped up in the experience.
We're the only people who go to work and drink for free, you know.
So when you were growing up, was piano like your first instrument?
No, I was a clarinet player. Mm. There was always a piano at home. My mother played and my father was a church organist. And so there was always a piano to mess around on at home, but I took up clarinet when I was about 13 and went on from there. And the reason I gave it up is because when I went to music college as a clarinet major, they didn't have any jazz clarinet players to teach. So I was stuck with the classical teacher. And I remember the first lesson, he said, "You're doing it all wrong. It's awful. You can't have to start from the beginning." And I told him, I said, "It's taken me years to get this tone. I'm not giving that up." You know, it was a big sort of Sidney Bechet type tone. And so I gave up clarinet as a major and took arranging or something, you know, and never had another clarinet lesson. So I never
did
had
you continue
piano lessons
playing
either.
Clarinet? Did you continue playing clarinet?
I did for a while, yeah. I went to Hong Kong for 3 years after college and doubled a lot on clarinet, but the piano sort of took over.
Did you go to Hong Kong for a gig or what?
Yeah. I went for a 6-month gig and stayed for 3 years, yeah.
Wow, playing piano?
Yeah, it's really where I learned how to play piano. Oh. I'd worked in one place for a year. it was a fascinating gig. It was a trio and there was a drummer and my best mate from college. We both left. It was 2 weeks before the final exam in college. And we got this call, would you like to go to Hong Kong for 6 months? And we thought, that's much more fun than taking exams. Let's do that. So we went to Hong Kong. And he played electric bass, banjo, guitar, all the stringed instruments. And I played clarinet and piano and a bit of rudimentary bass. And the sort of gig was, the first set would be very cool and sophisticated, and I'd play piano. It's where I learned a lot of tunes. And then we'd have to play a Dixieland set. And then we'd have to play a sing-along set. So I would play bass, wow, and, you know, if you knew Susie. Right? We almost had to wear, you know, straw boaters. I can't remember whether we did. I remember we wore striped shirts. So, but it was fabulous experience. We played all sorts of styles of music over a five-hour gig, you know.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. So at the end, wow, of that, anyway, I'd made enough money and I took 3 months off. I rented a grand piano and a little cottage in the New Territories in Hong Kong, almost in China, and rented a piano and decided to become a piano player. So I practiced for about 3 months and then was unbelievably lucky and got a gig in the poshest hotel in town, in the piano bar, the Peninsula.
Wow. Wow.
Where I so then great. Learned, I learned a million tunes because most of the regular customers at the piano bar in Hong Kong were folks in the rag trade from New York. Oh. And they would come in and say, do you know that Rodgers and Hart tune, blah, blah, blah. I said, no. He said, I'll bring you the music next time I'm in town, blah, blah, blah. And they'd bring me the music, obscure Rodgers and Hart musicals. And I learned all those songs, you know. So
wow.
It's funny how fate has so much influence on your life, you know.
Yeah, it's really amazing. I know this woman, Judy Carmichael, who's excellent stride player.
Yeah.
You know, her gig, her first gig or, you know, longtime gig was playing in at Disneyland, you know, out there in the sun, you know, stride, you know.
Yeah.
Got really good, you know.
Yeah, yeah. It's better than practicing. I've always learned on the gig. I learn on the gig. You know,
so. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you're kind of,
we were lucky being brought up when, I mean, there really was a lot of gigs. I mean, when I first came to San Francisco in 77, there were trios on every corner, you know.
Yeah.
Hotels with five piano players. There were so many gigs. Now there's nothing.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. That is a real, that just makes me feel like it was truly another life, you know.
Oh, it was. Coming, it makes me feel ancient as well. But I feel
I feel bad for my students, you know, like,
yes, actually.
You know, they're, especially the older ones, they're trying, the younger ones kind of have their groupings of people that they get together with at least and play. But the older ones, you know, they're kind of shy about getting together with people and they're not forced into the situation, you know. When you have a gig.
I've had drummers throw sticks at my head and, you know, it's how you learn. It was sometimes brutal on the bandstand. But if you survive that, no, I'm going to be a professional musician. I'm going to learn how to do this, you know.
I used to have a boyfriend who was from Texas, from Houston, and he was a sax player, and he would tell me horror stories about how he came up and, you know, go sit in, and like he'd call Night and Day in B flat and they would do it in A, you know, just to fuck. God. terrible stuff.
I don't recommend it. I really hated it, so I don't recommend it.
Yeah, but it is nice. It is a good idea. I mean, I play piano well enough to accompany my students and, you know, to figure things out for myself. And I've done little gigs where I'm singing and playing piano and there's another, like a guitar player to kind of take up the soloing and all that stuff. But to really, I've often thought I should just sit down and play through songs, just not even sing, because I can sing and play, but actually playing through the songs with the melody and, you know, letting your fingers kind of find spots to go and going, oh, I like that. You know, I need to do that.
that's how I learned just what sounded good to me.
You know? Yeah.
And that's where I never learned bebop heads. You know, I understand the harmonic language and everything of bebop, but so my improvisations, I think, I don't know whether they sound like bebop or not. That's interesting. Okay, I'll think about that.
Were you going to say they don't sound like bebop?
Yeah. So,
well, I mean, Bill Evans didn't really sound like bebop to me. Just sounded beautiful.
No, that's true. Yeah. I think of improvising is inventing new melodies.
Yes.
You know, upon whatever structure you're playing over.
So. And hopefully they're nice.
Yeah.
I'm going to go look for something else from you. I'm going to go look on YouTube, and maybe you can
look up Crazy Bat My Baby.
Okay, Mike Greensill.
Yeah.
Crazy about my baby.
There it is.
You are right. I'm crazy. This one? These the same one?
I think they are, yeah.
Okay.
Hey, Christopher here from Musical U.
Christopher is really good at his advertising.
Yeah.
He always comes on jazz ones.
I'm the world's most happy creature. Tell me, what can worry be? Well, I'm crazy about my baby. My baby's crazy for me. Mr. Cupid was a teacher. That's the reason we agree. Well, I'm crazy about my baby. My baby's crazy for me. Pastor, get your book out. Steady in your hand. Take a long look out. And you understand. It's an A1 combination. We are the perfect T and she. Well, I'm crazy about my baby. My baby's crazy for me. Tell me, what can worry be? Well, I'm crazy about my baby. My baby's crazy for me. Mr. Cupid was a teacher. That's the reason we agree. Well, I'm crazy about my baby. My baby's crazy for me. A positive, get your book out. Steady in your hand. Sail on, look out. You understand. It's an A1 count. reason, perfect key and she. But I'm crazy about my baby, crazy about my baby, my baby. Well, she's crazy about me to do pop, do 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 do.
Oh God, that's great! So you're a nice singer too.
Wow, thank you. I'm a character singer. I was a good boy treble, but when my voice broke, it all went away. So
you listening to you, I'm reminded of Mike and Lynn Poulter from Boston.
Oh yeah, yeah. I've recently reconnected with Mike Poulter, and we message each other now and then. Yeah.
Yeah, they're right down that alley too. It's a wonderful thing, and they've done it so long. They're so good at it and stuff, right. You know.
Yeah. I didn't used to sing because in the beginning with Weslia, there was only room for one diva in the family, so I wasn't allowed to sing. Then later on, when Weslia would get a little tired, she'd allow me to sing a song in the show, you know.
We'll have to listen to something with Weslia too.
Yeah.
Alan Asher said he listens to you almost daily and heard you and Weslia years ago at the Jazz Bakery. Ah, yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have.
Did that ever come back, the Jazz Bakery?
Yeah, but not in one location. Well, kind of. Basically, it wasn't in like their location. They move around now. And they ended up at a school, an art school. It's kind of under a famous name. I can't remember, but is it Quincy or?
Remind me of her name, the singer who ran it.
Ruth Price.
Ruth Price, of course. How could I forget?
Yeah. Yeah. So, so they had moved around. Actually, they just started doing some live.
Okay.
Streaming. Yeah. So that's kind of cool, right? I want to have Ruth on here too. I love her.
Right.
And she was always extremely supportive to me. And
good to us.
Yeah. Did you ever see like that old, there's video up of her singing?
Mm-mm. No.
She was very good. She was very, I mean, her good taste comes from somewhere. You know, she was a dancer and a singer.
Right.
And she stopped singing a long time ago, but she was beautiful, kind of Irene Crawlish, you know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Really good. Yeah, very nice.
All right.
Yeah, the bakery, that was just a great venue. Yeah. You know, in the beginning, the bakery was in that complex, but it was a smaller space,
right.
Much smaller space. That was a photography studio,
right,
of a photographer named Jim Britt. And so that was the beginning.
Yeah,
and he was a singer too.
Yeah.
yeah, nice guy, cool guy. Well, thank you. Yeah, the Jazz Bakery is at the Moss Theater lately. So, and you have people are mentioning you sound like Tony Bennett.
Oh no.
And you sound like who else? They said Bob Dureau and Dave Frischberg and
my heroes.
Yeah, and I'll throw Dave McKay in there. I mean, you know, there's a lot of great singing in that whole area, that whole genre.
Right.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
So very nice singing.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Have you composed as well?
Yeah. For the last 2 or 3 years before the pandemic hit, I was playing in a five-piece band, two saxophones, and started writing a lot of tunes for them to have something new to play. So yeah. I have a decent amount. In fact, I've been thinking of putting a little booklet out so that, of lead sheets so that people, because I play them on my live stream show and some of the piano players would like to play them. So I think I'm going to do that. So yeah, I've enjoyed that. I can.
Yeah.
The only trouble with writing songs is that every time you do it, you think it sounds like something else. Yeah, because we may have come to the end where the 12 notes of the popular music period, you know, can't be original anymore, you know. It's still something. So that's what I always feel. And in fact, I did just compose something, about 3 months ago, and played it on the show. And I kept saying to people, I said, it reminds me of something, but what is it? You know, and sure enough, it was another tune, you know, that I'd sort of channeled. it was a Judy Garland song from, Summer Stock. If you feel like singing, sing, da da dee da 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 da. And I'd written that. It was almost exactly the same. Well, throw that one away.
That does happen, you know. Yeah. I find that I write in kind of a series, like a painter would paint in a blue, you know, blue for a month or something, you know. And a long time ago, I realized that if I'm writing and it doesn't come out, you know, like a really cool jazz tune, to not stop, you know, just so what, just finish it or throw it away and continue on. Because as soon as you start getting into analyzing yourself too much, the muse just goes, okay, fine, I'll go away now. So you just do
lyrics. Lyrics are the hard thing. I don't do lyrics. I wish I could.
That's surprising.
I think I'm more envious of lyric writers than anyone in the music business. I'd like to be Johnny Mercer.
Yeah, there's some great lyrics. I remember, what was it? What is that song? It's one of the, is it My Foolish Heart? No, not My Foolish Heart. There was something about the slow, something, how slow it goes, and the actual music at that point actually stretches out so that the melody is slow, and they made it work so amazing. It's one of the classic standards. And I remember, you know, finding that and just, those are the treasures, you know. I always tell my students that that's where you find the treasure, you know, in the lyrics and the music together. It's like, it's marvelous. It's miraculous. Yeah. That's where you get your joy from, you know.
And that is the attraction to me of, you know, what we're now pretentiously calling the Great American Songbook. But it's that perfect wedding of lyrics and melody. And that's why you know, if I look at a modern song and I see 16th notes all over the place, I think, no, the person writing the lyrics didn't know how to edit themselves. So they had to get whatever they wanted to say in, which isn't a good marriage of lyrics and melody. So, which is why
it's so true.
Perpetually old fashioned.
Yeah. And like we were saying about those beautiful little gem tunes, it's not really about intricacies. It's about that magic. It's the magic, you know, that you're looking for and you find all of a sudden, and that's how you know it's working. It feels like magic, right?
Yeah. And if we had it, I would be Johnny Mercer. But...
And then you'd look very different.
Yeah. I love Johnny Mercer's singing, by the way. I love how he sings.
Oh God, I know. Yeah. I know. You know, I'm friends with Clark Burrows. He's one of the high lows.
Okay. Yeah.
The high voice.
Yeah, the high.
And he was in some film with Johnny Mercer, you know, when he was very young, singing. clowning around and stuff, you know. Really fun. Yeah, it's great to see. I wanted to know, and you know, I mistakenly corrected all the Weslia names to Weslia because I found it like that on the web, because I was wondering, is it Weslia or Weslia? It's Weslia, right?
Yeah. Well, it was all, the problem was, it was always pronounced Weslia, even when the I was in there. But Weslia's mother insisted that the I should be there, because her mother said, I named you after a school friend of mine in L.A. And many years later, this person appeared and said to Weslia, oh, why do you have an I in your name? I don't have an I in my name. So Weslia's mother had spelt it wrong all those years, but she insisted it was pronounced Weslia. So it was, in those days, it was a good way of telling whether you are a close friend of ours, because if you called her Weslia, you weren't a close friend, you know. Everyone who knew us well knew it was Weslia. So when Weslia's mother died, she decided to have it surgically removed. So so the early albums say Weslia and the other ones say Weslia, which I knew, and this was the dawning of the computer age. And I said, this is going to be a big problem if you can't spell it the same way. You know, you'll never be able to find your early albums.
But, you know, it's kind of good marketing, actually. You know,
anything, I mean, for publicity, anything. Yeah.
Exactly. You don't have to kill anyone or anything. No. You know. When did you guys meet?
About 1981, something like that. I'd just come back from, I was in Hawaii for a year with a trio, and a bass player friend of mine said, oh, you have to come and hear this singer I'm playing for. And so I did, and her piano player asked me to sit in, not to accompany her, but just to play for a last set opener or something. And so she called me a couple of days later and said, I need some new arrangements. Would you be interested? And I said, sure. And I went over to her place. We did some charts. And one thing led to another. I eventually started playing for her. And we were both married to different people at the time. But then eventually, and you can, funny, it's time to plug the merchandise. You can read all about it in here.
Oh.
We started calling ourselves the Whitfields, which is like a portmanteau word from Whitfield and Greensill. So we're the Whitfields.
Yeah, yeah.
And so this is the Whitfield scrapbook.
Yeah. And is this a kind of autobiography?
Yeah, it's an autobiography. Lots of stories about our recordings and gigs we've done and all about our lives, but it's lots of photos. It's a scrapbook sort of thing, but story of our lives before we met and then afterwards. And so yes, it is. To answer your question, it is a biography. anyone can get it by writing to me. I'm mike@mikegreensill.com. Very easily.
Very easy.
mike@mikegreensill.com.
That sounds really good. Hi, Pinky Winters.
Ah, Pinky's there.
Pinky girl.
Hello, Pinky.
She's the hippest jazz broad I know, actually.
Oh, yeah. And her album with Lou, I stole nearly every tune off of that album, especially Along With Me is a great one from there. Oh, loved it. Kisses, Pinky.
Now, Pinky is, you know, a singer in the ilk that we were speaking of, you know, just the excellent singers that came up, you know, in that whole period of time that were they were kings and queens of subtlety, even though they may not have, some of them may not have seemed so subtle, but they were, they just had these beautiful things that of course we kind of tore apart to learn what the hell are they doing.
yeah.
Oh god. Oh well, look at that. Monty, I didn't know you and Pinky know each other. Monty Montgomery. He's a lovely player. Does he hang out on your show too?
He does. Yeah, he does. He apparently says he practices the bass to my when I'm playing the show.
Oh, nice. Very nice.
I'm not going to tell him what the changes are, so he'll have to figure it out.
Are you a fan of any of the, let's say, the younger, newer players right now?
That's interesting. You know, maybe Bill Charlotte's one of my favorite piano players in all the world.
I love him too.
Just a fabulous piano player. And so I don't know that many 20, 30 year olds. There are some who just play too many notes. I do know that. But
I was talking with my friend today who you would like, Josh Nelson. He's from LA. He's a beautiful player. He's very sensitive. He can play anything with the guys who are, you know, playing anything right now, you know, but he also is really sensitive and very beautiful accompanist. I'll have to send you some of his playing.
Definitely be interested in hearing. Yeah.
Quite beautiful. I'll make myself a note. Do you like Dropbox links or do you like prefer CDs?
Oh, Dropbox is fine. Yeah. I'm that hip. I'm only partially hip, but I'm that hip.
Well, you seem pretty hip to me.
And that brings up the second plug, which I'm not going to plug anything else after this, is my book, Playing for Singers, for all those.
Oh, I'm going to have to get that, share it with some people.
I'll send you a copy, Cathy.
Thanks. Let's talk about that for a minute, because that is so hugely important. And I have tried to include that in workshops that I've created over the years, you know.
Go on.
I was just going to say, just to start the conversation about it, what is different about a playing for singers?
Yeah, you have to subsume your ego and listen. I think I start at the beginning of the book. There's three rules about accompanying. It's listen, listen, listen. So, don't be pushy. Don't, you know, piano players tend to think they know it all. They know what's best for you. So
I've experienced that.
Don't let the piano player bully you.
And I mean, obviously, a little bit like playing behind a solo, like a horn or, you know, that kind of featured instrument, but different because obviously the singer, you know, has the lyrics and the story so prominent.
And it's also, of course, very different whether you're playing solo piano or whether you have a rhythm section. I mean, you play completely differently under those circumstances, whether you have to be the whole orchestra or not. It's funny, comping is a thing, and as you say, comping behind soloists as well as singers, it's not something you can sort of practice at home. It's another of those things that you learn on the gig. You know, you have to work to figure out how to do all of that.
Yeah, because you're responding, right?
Yeah. So, but I go into all of that in the book.
In the book.
This one is has a proper publisher. This is by Share Music.
You know, that's really a proper publisher.
Yeah, right.
If you're with Share Music, you're going to make some money.
See, the trouble with that is all the piano players who need to read this book think they don't.
I totally get that. Yeah, I really do.
So the sales really are quite modest.
Yeah, I totally get that. And, you know, I always tell my student singers, but also whenever I get the chance for maybe a student pianist too, I always tell them, especially like rubato, for some reason, people who don't know think rubato is like not not, well, I don't know how to say it, but not as artful as it is. It's art.
It's the most difficult art. You know, Weslia was a great one for singing verses, and often, you know, the verse is done rubato or out of tempo, whatever you want to call it. And this, the situations where you have to follow the singer, or sometimes you have to lead, and mainly you have to really edit yourself so that the thing flows.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, and the difficult thing about this is the singer has to be good for you to sound good playing rubato. Yeah. The singer has to be good, else it's not going to work out, you know. So I have a whole chapter on playing rubato. So
that's interesting, though. I've never heard anybody say that, but of course it's true. But yeah. I've never heard anybody actually say that. I remember singing with Ross Tompkins, and it was a beautiful experience, you know. And I mean, you know how you have a musical relationship, and it's you're giving and taking all the time,
right.
And
absolutely
while you're communicating your own idea, and I'm sure you know that's for both people, you know,
right?
And it's an interesting thing.
There's a funny story that Jimmy Rolls told. He was playing for Sarah Vaughan somewhere in a club, and they had a break, and he went to the bar, and someone talked to him at the bar and said, "Jimmy, that was so fabulous. I couldn't stop listening to you. It was so wonderful." And Jimmy realized he'd been playing too pretty, because they weren't listening to Sarah, they were listening to him.
Oh,
so you have to beware of being too pretty.
Yeah.
But I would also tell singers, you know, in lots of situations, and also rubato, if you're leading from one section to another, I tell the singers, look, if I'm playing something pretty, it's not time for you to come in yet.
That's, yeah, I can understand that.
You have to listen as well as me. I interviewed a lot of people for this book, and one of my favorite interviews was with the late Sir Richard Rodney Bennett, who, if Pinky is still here, they were good friends.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, she's spoken of him. Yeah.
Yeah, right. And Richard hated being called an accompanist. He said, "I'm a collaborator, I'm not an accompanist. We're equal."
That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. my friend Roland is here. He's asking if you're familiar with the pianist named Otmaro Ruiz.
No, I haven't heard that name, no.
Yeah. He's a wonderful player. He's from Argentina, and he's brilliant. He's a real brilliant player, but he's very sensitive too. You know, he's right. Just a lot of things, you know. He's not that young. He's not like in his 20s. He's probably, I don't know, close to 50 maybe. Right. but yeah. Pinky says, "Holy cow, Richard was unique indeed."
Yeah. He was. Just loved Richard. Loved him.
Yeah. Yeah, Lou Matthews was a really amazing player too. Right. He just, I sang with him a bunch. And yeah, that was another really great experience. Yeah, nothing like, I mean, it's really beautiful. Rubato is just such a nice spot to live in for a minute, you know?
Oh, absolutely. best records to listen to. I love Carmen when she plays for herself. And I always tell, you know, people who want to learn accompanying, listen to singers who play piano for themselves and see how little they do. Listen to Blossom Dearie or Mose Allison. Listen to Mose when he accompanies himself, and Carmen. There's a great LP called Live at the Dug, which was a club in Japan, with the whole thing is just Carmen playing piano and singing. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if Sarah ever did that. I mean, I know she played.
She would close concerts by doing that. I've seen YouTube things where she sits down and plays for herself.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. I know several singers here who do that. And they're really, yeah. As a matter of fact, I just recently interviewed a bass player singer, well, two, but this one particular one who I hadn't really spoken with before, named Nancy Reed. She plays great electric bass. I mean, great. Yeah. And she also plays guitar. And amazingly, when she was playing guitar and singing, it was like two different people. Like they're, you know, like how you might be comping differently than I'm singing, right? You know, like, right?
Yeah.
But we're meeting, of course, in the middle, but we each have our unique thing happening. That was how she was playing guitar and singing. And she was accomplished at it. It just blew my mind. And she said she had listened to Carmen, you know, a lot growing up, and you could, oh man, just great, you know. She really brought some great stuff away. She lives on the East Coast. Really good singer.
Right.
Nancy Reed. And her husband is an outrageously good guitar player too.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hey.
It's one of the nice things about this show is not only do I, you know, can I hang with my friends, but also like you, you know, I haven't spoken with you before, and it's just, you know, it's a pleasure to get to know people and find out their histories and what they think, you know.
Yeah. Yes. Really fun. True. We all have a story to tell.
Yes, we do. I was thinking it would be nice to hear you and Weslia.
Yeah. Why don't you look up, you just mentioned My Foolish Heart.
Okay.
Type in Weslia and My Foolish Heart.
Alrighty. Oops, Esla.
You need a W. No. Yeah.
No. It's typing too fast, and I probably should put her last name.
There it is. Yeah.
Right here.
Yep.
Set for dreaming, love's knocking at the door. But oh my heart, I'm reluctant to start, for we've been fooled before. The night is like a lovely tune. Beware my foolish heart, how white the ever-constant moon. Take care, my foolish heart. There's a line between love and fascination. It's hard to see in a moment such as this. Well, they both give the very same sensation when you're lost in the magic of a kiss. Your lips, they're much too close to mine. Beware my foolish heart. But should our eager lips combine, then let the fire start. For this time it isn't fascination or a dream that will fade and fall apart. This time it's love, my foolish heart. they're much too close to mine. Beware my foolish heart. But should our eager lips combine, then
gorgeous.
Yeah. That was actually filmed at Aaron Keepnews, our record producer's memorial at Yoshi's.
Oh, really? I saw that Lorca was on drums.
Yeah, Lorca Hart and John Whitala. Yeah, and that was old DJ Dick Conti hovering in the background. He was the MC. He was a jazz DJ up here and a good piano player too. Yeah.
That's cute that he remained on the stage.
Yeah, I don't think he knew where to go. No.
Part of the band. He wanted to be part of the band.
Yeah.
Wait, she sounded just gorgeous. She looked like such a sweetheart too. I'm sorry I never got to meet her.
She could be tough.
Could be tough.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah. Oh yeah.
Tour though, you know.
We had our ups and downs, but they were all worth it.
I forget her story. What? How did she get into the wheelchair?
She was shot by two little kids on the street. She was leaving a rehearsal, and it's all in the book.
Okay.
So it was in a safe neighborhood in San Francisco, two little kids stopped her and said, give us your money or something. They were like 11, 10 or 11. So she laughed at them and said, oh, no, and walked away. And then she heard one say, shall I shoot her? And so the one kid shot her in the back. So, and that was that. Wow. So that was just before I arrived in San Francisco, 77. Yeah. Huh. So. Yeah. And then she made her way.
Yeah, man. Life changer.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
In many ways, I think artistically, and I'm never sure whether she agreed completely with me with this, that. Because actually, just before she was shot, she was going to New York to audition for a chorus of some Broadway show, because she danced a bit as well. So her career may have taken a completely different thing. But what the wheelchair did was focus everything on the song and on the performance of the song. So in a way, not being able to move anywhere made everything just in pure focus. So I really believe that was helpful to her becoming the artist that she became.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
Steve Taylor is here. He said his favorite song, you and Weslia, is It's Me, Remember?
Oh, Jimmy McHugh, yeah. That's an obscure, we were talking about gems, that's an obscure gem. I was thinking about that when you talked earlier about the Bergmans. When we first met them, we were doing a thing at the Taper in LA, and it was a tribute to Jimmy McHugh. Michael Feinstein was the host, and I was the piano player on the show. And I think we did that song, I can't remember now. But all Jimmy McHugh songs.
I don't know
we
if
did,
I know
we
that.
Did a whole Jimmy McHugh album.
So, oh, yeah.
Yeah. And that was with Gary Foster, who we talked about earlier, and Ken Poplowski. Okay. You should hear the two clarinets of, we did some two clarinet tunes with Gary and Ken Poplowski. Fabulous.
Wow.
Yeah.
That sounds good. What's that record called?
It's called, what's it called? Let's Get Lost.
Oh. So apparently Jimmy wrote that. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. I'm going to look that up.
Yeah. All of those tracks are on YouTube from that album.
Oh. Oh, we might have to listen to that one. did you actually kind of pretty much only play with Weslia, or did you play with any other?
No, I did play with other singers, people who were old friends. I played often for Denise Perrier here, fabulous singer, and Madeline Eastman. And
I was going to mention her because I figured you knew her and Vince.
Oh, we're old friends. And of course, her hubby, Vince Latiano, is on a lot of our records. So, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I had that thought in there.
It's all very incestuous in this world.
It is. It definitely is. Yeah. Yeah. Madeline's a friend of mine. Well, they're both friends of mine. And just wonderful. Great people and wonderfully talented. Yeah.
There's a lot of good singers in the Bay Area. In fact, I remember Stephen Holden of the New York Times once writing something about it, that he said there must be something in the water in San Francisco. They keep turning out these singers, you know. And and that actually inspired, Weslia was going to do a book, and she never finished it, on Bay Area singers. And she started interviewing people and just, you know, all the girl singers.
Who else is there
in the Bay Area? May Cavalero is a wonderful singer I play for occasionally.
May Cavalero, I know her.
Yeah, she's a wonderful teacher at the jazz school too. There's Jackie Ryan is a fabulous singer.
He's delicious.
I used to play for Jackie at the Ritz. Over the years, I think at times people were shy to call me because they thought I was just playing with Weslia. So that, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, I said, no, you know, she's not working that much.
Yeah. Speaking of a great singer and pianist, Dina DeRose is here.
Oh, Dina. Love Dina. Hello.
Wonderful. Hi.
Last saw Dina up in Napa. She was playing a club here for the Napa Jazz Society. She sounded fabulous.
Yeah. She's wonderful. I interviewed her on the show too. We had a good time.
Yeah.
Kitty Margolis, Steve Taylor said. Yep.
Kitty Margolis. Oh yeah, Kitty. I did some symphonic arrangements for Kitty.
Oh, uh-huh.
For some reason, did she go to Yale or something like that? Anyway,
I don't remember.
She had a gig with the Boston Pops and needed some arrangements. So, so I got to put on my resume, arrange for the Boston Pops.
And is arranging a big part of what you've done over the years?
It is. I taught myself how to orchestrate.
Of course you did.
Yeah. Because I've never had any lessons in anything. No. the shelves are full of, for the Russ Garcia professional arranging. So, I think we started about 1989. We got good friends with Michael Feinstein. And he was hitting his peak, and he was doing a lot of symphony pops gigs around the country, and he would get Weslia to open for him. So not having any symphony charts or any money, I thought, well, I'll do it. So I did.
Wait, you mean, Do you mean for her?
Yeah, with for the orchestra. Yeah, no, for Weslia.
I see. That's really cool.
Yeah. And again, you know, we talked earlier about my accompanying style and my piano playing and the fact that I'm self-taught and I don't have all that technique. A similar thing came into use, I think, with the orchestration thing. Because I found that I wrote things that were properly supportive of the singer without getting in the way. So many symphonic arrangements, you know. I remember the first concert we had to do, I was a little behind, and I had a good friend who I knew could do this, and I asked him to do a couple of arrangements. But he hadn't done symphony before. He'd done big bands, and he was so excited about writing for the symphony that he wrote World War III behind her. You know, I think he used every instrument combination he'd ever thought of ever been taught. And it was not a good chart for accompanying us. So again, I learned that lesson that less is more. And it was a good job that I didn't know more. So
Yeah.
And then I ended up doing quite a lot of arranging. I did a lot for the Buffalo Philharmonic, did a whole Joni Mitchell show and that sort of thing. So, yeah, I haven't done any in a while, but for a while I was doing a lot of arranging.
Yeah, I'd like to hear something of that. Is some of your arranging on YouTube, do you think? Like for that kind of?
Well, you can hear, there's some string arrangements, let me think.
By the way, Michael Abene also is self-taught.
Great arranger. Yeah.
Yeah.
I met him with Michael Moore. You know, for years we worked with Michael Moore, bass player, who's just the most fabulous musician. And I remember having breakfast with him and Michael in LA. So anyway, what was I trying to think of?
You were trying to think of like an arrangement.
Yeah. If you put in Weslia with the moon's a harsh mistress.
Ooh. I love that song. Ooh. I guess I heard Norma Winstone do that first.
I first.
You know of Norma Winstone?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she's another beautiful singer. Okay, let's see. Hold on. I'm getting my shit together. So, here's one version, but that's probably
that
not
the white one.
That looks like it's a trio, probably. Moon's a harsh mistress.
No, it would. We can hear my arranging for string quartet here if you like.
Right here,
do the Harry Warren medley.
Okay, great.
So,
you ever wondered what actors and actresses do when they?
I have never wondered. I have to pay to skip those ads.
My love must be a kind of blind love. I can't see anyone but you. And dear, I wonder, do you find love an optical illusion too? Are the stars out tonight? I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only have eyes for you. But I can't see a thing. sky. 'Cause I only have eyes for you. I don't know if we're in a garden. Maybe millions of people go by, but they all disappear from you. And I only have eyes. I don't care what the weatherman says. When the weatherman says it's raining, you never hear me complaining. I am certain the sun will shine. I don't care how the weather vane points. When the weather vane points to gloomy, gotta be sunny too. When your eyes look into mine. Jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? Jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those eyes? Jeepers, creepers, where'd you get those peepers? Oh, those weepers, where'd you get those eyes?
Kronos Quartet. So,
yeah. Oh God, they're
not so, their usual stuff.
Yeah, man. Yeah, so nice. I love how strings are now becoming more and more part of jazz programs and right. You know, jazz groups. It's such a beautiful idea.
Yeah. I mean, not to be critical, though I am going to be.
Okay, tell us what you really think.
I'd have liked a jazz violinist on first violin there. It needed a little more attacking and a grip. But who did it? Did it? You know. So.
Yeah.
David did his best, but
you know. Okay.
Needed more attack.
That wasn't too critical, actually.
Okay.
That was, I mean, you know, that's kind of realistic too.
Yeah.
Although, you know, Dina would like to know what pianist most influenced you as an accompanist.
Jimmy Rolls. Yeah, Jimmy.
Yeah.
And also, as I said before, all those piano players who play for themselves.
Yeah.
There are a lot of Blossom Dearie, a lot of Nat King Cole.
Yeah.
And like, you know, Dina herself and Diana Krall. Diana Krall's a great piano player.
Accompanies a great
herself piano perfectly. So those are the ones. And there's other, Norman Simmons.
Oh, yeah.
I tried to interview him for my book, but I couldn't get a hold of him. I think he's still with us. He played for Carmen a lot, Norman Simmons. Yeah, and she was tough on piano players, apparently. So,
I told somebody this on the show the other day, but in LA we used to have a place called the Parisian Room, and I was very young. I was in my early 20s, I guess. Went to see her again. Not a lot of people in the audience, and she literally kicked the piano player off the bench and sat down. And I just thought, oh my God, how humiliating is that, you know?
It's funny how one or two things are the most influential things in your life. And there's one record of Carmen with Jimmy Rolls. I think it's live at Dante's. And it was in mid-70s. Yeah. And Joe passes on it, and Chuck DeMonaco. It's the most swinging thing I've ever heard. And the way Jimmy accompanied her was just so exciting to me. It's funny, I remember hearing that because when I was living in Hong Kong, I used to drink in this sort of Chinese girly bar in the afternoons with a retired airline pilot, and we would play cribbage in the corner. But the guy who owned it was a Swedish sailor who'd retired, but a big jazz fan, and he had a tape recorder underneath the bar. So we would sit in the corner. We weren't into the other stuff, and sit in the corner and play cribbage and listen to Carmen McRae and Jimmy Rolls. And it was just the most influential thing I remember.
Wow.
You know, if That's I hadn't great. Had a dissolute lifestyle, maybe I'd have never heard this record and not be the accompanist I am today.
Yeah, that's right. I'm not sure how to put this into words. As the years went on and you were, you know, obviously playing, especially for Weslia and for other singers and arranging and doing all this stuff. During that time, did you also listen to anybody particular in jazz, or were you kind of ensconced in that universe?
That's interesting. I think, you know, I was a big fan of Cleo Lane and John Dankworth. I love Dankworth's arranging. I stole every idea of his. I stole everything. I think it was Stravinsky who said, you don't borrow, you steal from the best. You know? And so I stole a lot from Dankworth. But now I've forgotten the bent of your question.
it was. Did you listen to other music, or were you just really ensconced in that?
Yeah.
Universe, you know.
When I first started doing those orchestrations, I listened to a lot of classical music because I had a lot of catching up to do. I hadn't heard that. So I did a lot of listening to that. Not so much jazz. And you know, the funny thing is I don't listen to that much jazz these days. And when I do, it tends to be the things that inspired me in the first place. You know.
Yeah.
So I sometimes feel guilty about that. But that's how it is. I listen to more classical music than I do jazz, that's for sure.
So. Yeah. I love the guilt.
And it's almost because when you get to my ancient age, you've heard a lot of jazz. And it's no longer what Whitney Balliot beautifully called the sound of surprise. jazz doesn't surprise me much anymore.
Yeah, that's interesting. I listened to last week, I think it was the International Day of Jazz that Herbie Hancock kind of had instigated, you know, over the last 5 years. And it was really beautiful. You can find it on YouTube. Mm-hmm. A beautiful event, several hours with really different groups and from all over the world. And I found myself in the middle of it just literally being thrilled. Yeah. I was thrilled. I felt so good. I was like, it had really sparked me, you know, and which I loved, you know. I mean, I find it very overwhelming right now to keep catching up with people, both, you know, I try and see people live occasionally online, you know, like right. when they're doing it. Yeah. But sometimes I try not to beat myself up or feel guilty too much because right. I can always right. listen, you know, but right. there's so much to listen to that.
That's another thing. We're absolutely saturated, aren't we, with everything, yes. with information, with music, you know, which is why I think I find myself going back to playing a Jelly Roll Morton record instead of, you know, because that's what turned me on, you know. So.
Yeah. It used to be like I would have in my kitchen. No, we redid my kitchen. So now I have to wrap my brains around a new method of listening to music in there. Uh-huh. I had a stereo in there with 6 CD spots. Yeah. And I found myself listening to the same CDs for like 2 weeks at a time, which was great because I could really soak it in. Right. And now, of course, I have a speaker and I have to either, you know, tell my computer to send it to the speaker or do it on my phone.
Right.
And I put my CD player in the back room, you know, where I do some of my work. And yeah, so it's really different. It's a really different time. It's a really different time. Yeah. I'm actually going to a live gig today.
Oh, wow. All right.
Yeah, with some of my favorite Los Angeles musicians. RTM is a wonderful jazz cellist. Well, he's not only a jazz cellist, but he plays jazz. And with an amazing Armenian piano player, Vardan of Sepian. Right. And he's an incredible player. And so it's outdoors and it's at an interesting sounding venue that I haven't been to before called Second Home. Which is, it's like, as far as I can tell, there are several locations around the world, London being one actually, and where these architects built a complex that where you, if you want to go work on something, either papers or, you know, or your computer or something, you can go there. And it's very open and comfortable, and there's lots of plants in there and outside as well. So I have to take a tour, actually. I want to take a tour, but today I'm going for the concert. So I'm looking forward to that. Yeah. I'm always interested.
I actually got called for my first live gig, so which is with another old friend of mine who's on a lot of our records, Noel Jukes, fabulous saxophone player. No, so he's doing a birthday gig for himself. So I'm going to play with that.
When is that?
June 6th, I think, at the Back Room in Berkeley. June 6th.
Cool. Yeah. Are you going to have live people in the audience or?
Yeah, apparently it's outdoors. So, we'll see. Yeah.
It's an interesting time.
I'm not a big fan of outdoor playing. I don't know.
Well, no, me too.
I like smoky nightclubs, you know.
Me too. Although I do have to say my jam session is in a really nice outdoor venue. It's a patio and the acoustics are surprisingly really quite nice. And the audience is not too far and spread out, you know, not exactly like a small club, but it's got a really nice feel, you know?
Yeah.
So you should come to my jam. It's this Saturday.
Okay, I'll fly down. Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Gee, I really am due a trip to LA to see my dear friend Gary Foster. So
I spoke to Gary. I asked him if he would be on this, and he declined because I think he said he's not technically
right,
you know,
and acute. Gary's getting on a bit too, so.
Some people like Steve Hofstetter, I wanted on here, and he didn't really have the camera thing down. You know, some people just, they haven't been there really, you know, they just, you know, it's just not in their wheelhouse yet, you know.
I'm having terrible trouble. Maybe that you have technical people online. You know, I do my Facebook Live thing just on the iPhone. And you always have to, when you go live, you have to go through two or three icons to make sure that the picture is turned around the right way. Else everything is the wrong way around. And suddenly the icon for that, that enables you to do that, has completely disappeared from Facebook. So on
have
Monday,
you tried have you tried it on your computer?
No, because my computer's at the wrong angle, you see. My piano's
oh, do you have a desktop or not? Yeah,
use the iPhone, and I put it on a stand right here next to the piano, so it looks up the piano keyboard and at me. And it purely by accident, it's turned out great. The sound is wonderful for the piano. I don't need to use a microphone or anything. So it's so simple and worked out good. So, except now I'm the wrong way around. It's very disconcerting when your right hand, instead of going up the piano, is going down. It's all wrong.
There must be, you know what you should try? You should try Googling it.
Oh yeah, I've spent the morning doing that and not quite
you have.
The right answer.
I wonder if I know of anyone who's I could ask my my social media guy. He's very sharp. He's a younger guy, and he does all my social media stuff. I'll ask him. Okay. I'll make a note of it.
Tell him the screwdriver icon has disappeared.
Is that what it is?
It's a screwdriver icon. Yeah, it's called the tool icon. And I don't want to take up your listeners' time with this arcane technical knowledge.
That's okay. I mean, you know, this is the reality of right now, what's happening, you know.
Right.
It just is, you know. Yeah. But don't worry about it. I'm sure nobody's going to throw you out of the room. We are coming to the end, and so I want to encourage people to go on your website and buy your books.
you can't get it on the website yet, because I haven't figured out, talking about technical things, how to take credit cards. So but if you write to me, mike@mikegreensill.com, I can tell you how to get it. And
okay,
there it is. And then the other one's easy, Playing for Singers, sharemusic.com, share music.
That's easy.
Yeah.
I do want to say to you, Mike, that it's very easy to put a PayPal button on your site, and they could just do it that way. They could go in.
I've been trying to do, PayPal does do a credit card thing where you can take credit cards, and I've been attempting to do that.
Yeah, and they just give you a little button that you actually can put on your site if you're in control of your site.
No, I have a friend in England who does it. So,
yeah, that's easy.
But yeah,
actually, and I wouldn't say it if it wasn't true.
But people can still go to my website and find out more things than you ever wanted to know about me. So, mikegreensill.com. Go there.
And then, of course, Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, 3 to 4 Pacific time.
Yeah.
Obviously, you're back. You're back.
Back. Yeah, my foot's getting better, and I'm back.
Yeah. And so Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays, 3 to 4 Pacific time on Facebook. You can see Mike and hear him play.
Yeah.
And you can converse with him through comments.
Lots of Irving Berlin tomorrow because it's Irving's birthday today. So lots of Berlin tomorrow.
I have a friend who really thought the world of Irving Berlin, so I'll tell him.
Yeah, good. All right.
Let's see. Before I let you go, I'm just going to tell people tomorrow I have on live. I have an old friend of mine, a pianist and a producer named David Diggs. And Thursday through Sunday will be my archives. Uh-huh. And so Thursday, speaking of good singers, Sheila Jordan and Jay Clayton will be. And then Friday, a trumpet player, producer down here named Tony Guerrero. Saturday, a guitarist who I think of as the West Coast John Scofield named Jeff Richmond.
Yeah.
And Sunday, another great singer, Kenny Washington.
Oh, I played for
Kenny. Forgot to mention him. Yeah, in San Francisco.
Yeah, I played for Kenny quite a lot. Fabulous singer. Yeah.
Yeah, he's yeah.
I'm so glad he's getting recognition now because he didn't for a while. Me too. You know,
but, I know who else we forgot. Mary Stallings.
Oh, yes, Mary. Good God. One of the most frightening concerts I ever did was for KCSM, the jazz station. And the lineup was Denise Perrier, Weslia, and Mary Stallings. And Mary never turned up for a rehearsal. And Denise was on first, then Weslia. And it's the intermission, and there's still no Mary. So I go out and play an overture for the second half of the concert. Mary turns up, walks out on stage. And I thought, what are we going to play? We haven't rehearsed. We haven't done anything, you know. So she just turned to me and called tunes. And that's frightening. And luckily, I knew the tunes. And it was okay, and they weren't difficult, and the keys were okay. But I thought, Jesus, you know, there's all these people in the audience, and I could have, anyway, that's my Mary Stallings story.
But she really, I mean, she could sing Our Love Is Here to Stay, and you can be in love with it.
Oh, no, fabulous singer. Yeah. I mean, world-class singer, Mary, yeah.
Yeah, really beautiful.
Yeah.
Well, Mike, thank you so much for spending 2 hours with me, you know, and us. Really loved hanging out with you.
It's been my pleasure. See you later.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye, everybody.